did you learn the concept of the model village?
There is a two important discourse. First discourse, UN Secretary General Kofi Annan told that already there is a lot of international instruments, in international norms and the standards for the protection of the human rights and democracy, but the biggest problem on the implementation on the grassroots level. And the second biggest discourse we learn, people like me learn from the Gandhiji and the Babasaheb Ambedkar. Gandhiji always talks about to save the village republic. And Babasaheb asks about the who is going to benefit by the village republic. Only upper caste man. So in that way, the whole concept of Babasaheb, social democracy of Dr. Ambedkar and the concept of the village republic. Because if the village republic is going to destroy Gandhi, who is going to receive more threats, more problems, mostly the marginalized community, Dalit community. So it in that way we started to create a model, and model in the sense because how to implement the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and the spirit of the preamble of constitution in the villages, and what is the learning. And from that concept, we established the model village, and then we have many concepts. So few people have the entry point focus child rights, few people have the women rights, we recently started to torture and organize violence.
So because before that you work on the Bachpan Bachao Andolan, focusly on the child labor, rescuing, helping the victim in individual cases. So how that ideas came in your mind that you had to first create the, as I heard that you, from your reports, that you created Indrawar as a child-centric model village. So what was the main focus behind motivating you to concentrate not on the individual cases but for the whole community?
But the most important thing, because Bachpan Bachao Andolan and people like me, everybody involved to rescue a lot of bonded child labor. And the child labor. But the most important thing, not a single bonded child labor belongs from the upper caste community. Mostly from the Dalits, OBC, Muslim minority, lower strata of the Muslim minority and all. Why? Because there is a problem of the caste system. And second important thing, there is no education for the children in that time. India government, the Indian constitution did not talk about the fundamental rights to the education. And in that way, we are rescuing the people and a lot of children are coming back. Because the children are coming from the pockets, there is no land reform, no livelihood option for parents, and also the no education for the children. So then we adopted Indrawar to learn ourselves. And from there, we have the union for the parents to fight the rights and to implement the all welfare schemes, activation of the schools and education for the children. And in that way, we found that we created child labor free villages. From there we understand if you are creating the community, then it is more preventive. One hand, you eliminate and also empowering to the community, they will fight not by some individual heroes and heroines, but the real heroes and heroines are coming from those communities.
So in between you created the child-centric model village, which is still being implemented. But in 2010, you conceptualized the idea of the torture-free model village. So what was that idea of the torture-free model village? Because it is different from the bonded labor and child labor. And why did you selected those village where you are now concentratedly working?
You look that with the CRI and the Tata Trust and many donor agencies, we started child rights centered village, and already we completed. But the most important thing, when you are going to create the union of the parents, there is a culture of silence, and this cultural silence imposed by the organized violence based on the caste and also the police that was supported by police torture. So without the breaking that cycle, it is impossible to create an empowered human community in villages. So in that that time we had the interactions, we understand that dynamics, but we had the interactions with the Dennis organization, Dignity, that time RCT, but the name is changed after Dignity, Dennis Institute Against Torture. And we learn and we develop also testimonial therapy, because this is the biggest problem, how to support individual. We have the counseling, we are giving the empathetic supports, honor ceremony and other things. But we did not create a real brief narrative therapy like a testimonial therapy. So we developed that, and we integrate this testimonial therapy and also the whole our learnings from the model village. But here more political, because more political in this sense, if really you break the culture of silence imposed by organized violence based on the caste system, based on the patriarchy and the police torture, then you are going to create real inculcating process of the empowerment in the community, and that is the whole idea. And why we choose these villages, because this is the we received the cases of the police torture, and there is a mostly in like Banaras mostly Mushahar community, and they always face highest number of police torture against them, and they are most disempowered community. In that way also other our activists choose in the Ambedkar Nagar, Kodarma, Allahabad, Sonbhadra, like Ghasia tribes. So we did not choose the community like that. We are not aware about that. We have the baseline data, discussions among self, not myself is only involved, they all our team members and everybody, they will involve, and strategically we choose this area where we already working, we understand community, but there is a lot of prevalence of the police torture, a lot of prevalence of the caste system, there is a strong prevalence of the culture of silence. So we choose that community, and we started to that, and because it is the villages, but we have the model block also. So how the block process is coming? Because just like if you are throwing a stone into the water, ripple effect is going. So ripple effect is coming. Oh, this village, this is happening. So other village also started to join, and also there is a lot of happening on the police and all. So that strategical, tactical understanding we have our mind that time, and collectively in the management team of the PVCHR and also the staff, key staff and our volunteers, we discuss with them and we discuss with the community, and in that way after the baseline data and the focus group discussions, we choose and we decided to work in that village.
So how the process of model village interlink with the concept of the social work, the community based approach? So how these two processes integrate or interlink with each other?
You look that what is the community? So we have the very good understanding what is the community. So community is the collection of the individuals. So we and the second important thing, when we choose the villages, we have the anthropological understanding, community-based planning. Because Mushahar community is different from Nut community. Nut community is very different from Ghasia community. Ghasia community is very different from the different Dalit community and different tribal community. So we have first we collected community, understand community through the focus group discussions and the secondary data, and after that, and then then we will decide. And why it is a community based? One important thing, breaking the culture of silence through psychosocial supports and creating the hopes, honor and human dignity, these three H. And the most important thing, if you are going to look that through that, we are creating also cadre building, so they will fight themselves, and we have the accessibility in this way. This is the police station, this is the block development office, this is the district development office, this is the our New Delhi, our Lucknow, and all common property resources. What is the accessibility of that community? And we are started to discuss with them, and slowly, through the folk school discussion, through the honor ceremony, and through the human rights street movement, they started to fight themselves. And this is the very difference between the client-based approach and community-based approach. Here is also client, but belief is that this model for the people and by the people. So we mostly believe on the people, and we are not looking the people as a victim. We are looking at people as a survivor. So, and when we are looking the people as a survivor, so we observe that first we have the hypothesis, but now that we understand, working 2, 3, 4 years, like how survivor converted into the human rights defender.
So, as you already told that you developed the testimonial therapy with along with Ingal Agar and with the support from Dignity, but how the testimonial therapy actually in the grassroots or is providing a psychosocial support to the individual and reintegrating their medical their mental status. So, how it's working?
You look that we choose the testimonial therapy for two reasons, because in the Chile also that is a lot of culture of silence. Dictatorship, so that time people use the test money, and we also use the test money, but not the component of the real active listening. We are using the empathy on honor, and so here is active listening is most important, empathy is most important, third is the honor ceremony. So this honor ceremony, giving the dynamics of the human dignity, that is our integrations, and we also use the mindful meditations and how to support the peer group support, one for all for one. In that way, we utilize the testimonial therapy. So other group all over world use the testimonial therapy for the individual. But here we create the testimonial therapy, breaking the culture of silence, and started, and in that way people develop their institutional memories in community about how the police torture is happening, how the caste atrocities is happening, how the domestic violences are happening, how the violence against women are happening. And in that way, that creates the preventive way. And also people have the knowledge about the law, other thing, the fights. So that awareness also creating the preventions for them and the knowledge for them. And when the police look in the many villages, police came to the Mushar people. Initially they came, they ran away. Now they are aware about their law. They are started to talk about the Supreme Court judgment, D.K. Basu guideline. And in that way, creating the awareness to the police that this community is not like that before 4 years, 3 years before, 2 years before. They are changing, and they have the knowledge, they have the informations, they have the empowerment, and that they started to visualize. So when we started to work in these villages, that time, any crime happened, they caught the Mushar people. But now, it is not happening in this Phulpur and the Badagaon Thana in that way. And also that time, we also rescued a very little bonded labor from brick kilns, because mostly Mushar people are working. But nowadays, a lot of release, also the National Human Rights Commission supports, and many players jump into that. Many funding agency, many organizations nowadays working, releasing a lot of bonded labor from bricklaying industry, and bricklaying industry is nowadays just like carpet industry when the Kailash ji and started. So that is our contribution of this modern village initiatives in the advocacy to changing, not only changing the agenda setting of the real issue of the what the going to face by the most marginalized people of the area.
So with the whole work of the model village, because already you said that you intervene with different institutions, different stakeholders. So how the works change the attitude of the different stakeholders, just like Tahsil, police station, and commissions or administration, how they are listening? So how the attitudes are
because changed? In the testimonial therapy and in our there's a emotion is also, their pain, agony, and one hand the empowerment. So this story with the pain, agony, with the emotions, first time going through the National Human Rights Commission, just like National Human Rights Commission organized a camp. They told, wow, this is happening with the Mushahar and this is happening in the in India. So in that way, they have a lot of awareness and they recognize what is happening with the most marginalized community in this area. Second important thing, that story also giving a lot of emotions to the people. And the simultaneously, the empowerment recognized by the police, recognized by the tahsil. Because before, 4 years before, Mushahar did not come to the police. They are so much fear. And they did not come to the subdivisional office. They did not come to the block office. Now they were coming. And before that, that was represented by us. Means our activists, our volunteers. But nowadays, they become themselves as a community leader. And they are giving their own story like a human rights defenders. Because the whole concept is not like a victim. Whole concept is a survivor century. Ki they are survivor and they are fighting. So that creates lot of, it is inter-institutional approach that creates a lot of supports. Look, block. I just described one incident. I went to the deputy superintendent of police office in Pindra and a clerk was there. And he told, amazing, I visited the Mushahar ghettos, I visited the many places of the Mushahars. Now we are talking, they are very different. They are more clean. And we never started any sanitation program. We never started any clean program. Only we are giving the sense of dignity. And that sense of dignity and also to realizing that how other empowered communities are living, powerful communities are living. And in that way, they created their own agenda, they changed themselves. We never teach them to, you have the good cloths and all. Poor people, already Bhagat Singh told, poor. If you have the poor, how you are going to use the soap? Because you have not purchasing power to buy the soaps and the cloths. But after this fight, they are receiving work in Narega, lands, few villages, the land allotment, housing, more work. No, after releasing from bonded labor, they receive a lot of compensation, and that compensations and other thing giving a lot of empowerment. And nowadays, they influence to police. No, this and mindset is changed. They are talking very differently. They are unfeared people, but because we through the testimonial therapy, we are eliminating the hatred also. And we are telling, we started a reconciliation movement. So upper caste community also started to join our honor ceremony. Because we are telling, we are against caste system. We are against the abuse of the power. But we are not against the person born in upper caste community. We are not against the people who are in the power. But we are against the abuse of power. We are against the caste system. And in that way, they are started to joining, started to support a lot of reconciliations, many discussions, police officials also involved into that. Bigger officials started to listen to them, listen their stories. And in that way, a lot of impacts. So first time we use the emotion, empathy, empowerment, join together.
So as you said that you started the reconciliation movement and recently you conceptualized the idea of the Neo-Dalit movement, because already you were working with the different pockets, some were Dalits, minorities, the other Mushahars or other OBCs. So how you were integrating the both the upper caste, other backward class and the lower caste, because without integration it is the Neo-Dalit movement, and how it worked in the village where you were working?
Yeah, before that, there is a big debates in the NGO movement, because in the NGOs and other movement, human rights struggles also, few people want to start the conflicts and not resolving the conflict in positive way, and they are using that conflicts to create more conflicts. But our understanding is very clear what the Buddha told. If you want to eliminate the hatred, not by the hatred, only by the love. And in that way, because you look, the first I am going to describe PVCHR. PVCHR also established by the upper class, upper caste people. But nowadays, if you look, the staff and governing board, there is integrations and all. Not only integrations, with the empowerment, Dalits, OBC, Muslims, everybody are involved. And the most important thing, how we are focusing the justice, but after the justice, empowerment is also very, very important through the stakeholders. Because we understand the privileged community. If you born in privileged community, then you have a lot of privilege and you are enjoying the privilege. But there is no platform to discuss with the two types of community. And in that way, we choose the caste system wanted to divide us. The sectarian thinking of on the base of religion, on the base of gender, divide us. So we started to create unity, and that unity named as Neo-Dalit movement. Neo-Dalit movement is very brief in this way. Already Dalits, OBCs and tribals are fighting against caste system, but the people who born in the upper caste, but they are against caste system, they will make the unity with the Dalits, OBC and tribals against caste system. And second, already my Muslim minority, Christian minority and other minority, they are attacks by sectarian fascist forces, communal fascist forces, and due to that they are also broken people like Dalits, and they are already fighting. But there is people who not belongs to minority, but they are secular, they believe in communal harmony, so make a unity with them. Is the second type of unity. Third unity, because the neoliberal policies, I'm not talking about the democratic capitalism but and welfare states, but the neoliberal policy creating the gaps between have and have nots a lot, and that creates broken a lot of poor people, and poor people from any caste, any community, any nationality. So in that way, any sex. So the most important thing, how to make the unity of the poor people against the neoliberal policies. And all three unity we talk as the Neo-Dalit movements. Because the Dalit movements in India is very successful, and in this 25 years, so we want to honor to the Dalit movement in this way. And Neo-Dalit movements, because what the Baba Sahab gave the preamble of constitution. So it is the real implementations of the preamble of constitution in the Neo-Dalit movement. So Rajbhar community, Brijesh Pandey, Lenin Rabbansi, they will also fighting for the mushars of the area. So with the real conviction. But it is the most important thing why we are talking about the reconciliation. Because if you want to any treatment, it is important you need a diagnosis. So most people are telling there is no caste system. We are telling why you are hiding. There is a caste system. There is abuse by the power. And in that way, if you recognize, if you diagnose, and if you want to diagnose, you need to recognize, need to confess. And when you need to confess, you are going to confess, then you are going to start a reconciliation. Just like we are giving one example, like Sakra village, where is honor ceremony. We organize after 2 days of the Holi. And there is a mostly perpetrator where I born. And then after the honor ceremony, I stand up and I told, I born in this caste, I am against caste system, and that make a human being as an unhuman, and so it is the reconciliations with you, please give the pardon, and that become very emotional and real connections of the human being. It is giving a lot of pleasure to me also, and a lot of empowerments and this pleasure, and also the empowerment for myself, giving the real convictions and the courage to fight back to caste system. So that is the whole simple idea, but that is working in our modern village, and that creates a lot of dynamics. So they wanted to divide, and we are appealing. We are not against any upper caste people. If you want to join, you join. But don't hide, please support the justice process. We don't want to sympathy, we need the empathy.
So overall we want to say that it is creating a resilience within the different communities.
Yeah, it is creating the resilience between amongst and between inside community, amongst the community, making each other, breaking the gender, resilience against the gender, breaking the resilience against this sectarian thinking based on the religion, interacting of the different beliefs into in, and we organize it like a Banaras convention. It's a big convention, first time. It is the resilience of the Hindu, Muslim, different religious leaders on the Kabir Choraman. And you look, the first time Swami Mukteswaranand came and he talked Sadguru, Bandagi, three times. What if, recognizing the Sadguru Kabir in that way, person from the Adi Shankaracharya philosophy, recognizing that. And in the same way, Maulana Harun Rashid, Maulana Batin, and the Buddhist monk, and the director of diocese was there, were there. And that creates a lot of reconciliations and interaction with each other in the very positive way. And to recognizing what is the negative in every community, and we want to eliminate that on the basis of the values.
So, as you already told that the concept, the whole concept of the model village create from victim to survivor to human rights defender. So, what is the whole concept and how it's work?
The whole concept, we did not recognize the victim. We are recognized the survivor. What is the difference between the victim and survivor? When we are looking a person a victim, then you are promoting the victimhood. Survivor means, and also you are not recognizing the power of the him and her, because that person is fighting. That person had the own power. So not recognizing his and her power and his and her dignity and the capacity to fight back. The most important, and then in that way, a survivor means a person who faced the injustice, who faced the exploitation, but he and she is fighting against that. And if different community and the human rights organizations and different techniques, tools and psychological support, psycho-legal support help to him and her to convert from survivor to the human rights defender. And we found that. Now, once upon a time, a survivor of the bonded labor, police torture, they are fighting for others, like us, like a human rights defender. So this is the whole simple concept. And the most important thing, the breaking the silence and creating the resilience, himself and herself, and also in the community, and that resilience increasing, and creating more solidarity, more impacts as a ripple effects, and that creates a hope ki ek din naya zamana aayega, matlab the once upon a day new world is coming, new world order is coming, which is where is the every human being is going to treat as equals.
So how the work of the model village will sustain, because it is not possible to work in a village for a long time. There is a time duration, there is a resources needed, many things are there. So if we exit that village, how the concept of the model village will sustain?
It is very important. When we started to work, we worked 3, 4 years, 6 years, 7 years. Nowadays, in within the 1 and 2 years, we already created a resilience against the culture of silence. And after that, a lot of resilience in the community. And then we started cadre building. In the survivor who converted human rights defender, we created the cadre building to them, giving the knowledge to them. And also creating the resilience among different community. We did not happen before that. And that creates a very sustainable, I will give the example of the Ayer village. Before that also, we went there, that the Mushar person told, Nat Sahab, this time I stand for the village panchayat election. We understand politics. Now we speak out. only the problem is to write the application. So we will come to office and please put your resources to other villages for our people to create the same dynamics in other villages. So 3-4 years that become very sustainable. So we have the through the talking with the community worker, management team, the staff involved in this PVCHR and dignity, they created indicator how converting A level village, B level village, C level village. So we have the encounter, intensive engagement, then intensive engagement, and after intensive engagement, engage and encounter. Again, that is led by the survivor converted into the human rights defender and community workers.
So how much resources is required to create the model? Look, is it expensive or it is cost effective?
No, it is very cost effective because testimonial therapy is a brief narrative therapy. You look in the, we choose 10 villages in one block only two people, one community psycho community worker we pay and one is a model block coordinator. So not big big expense. What we created in 70 villages, and other that we trained a lot of people in the all over India, and we create a lot of discussion, debates. We contributed in advocacy also of the for the ratification of UNCAT and anti-torture bill, and nowadays we started to discussion about the optional protocols related to the UNCAT, and in that way we bring a dynamics in National Human Rights Commission, high courts, and in bonded labor few cases in the Supreme Court also. So that is very, very cost effective. If you are going, it is most cost effective in comparison to other initiatives, what is happening, especially in India in this area.
In last questions, if you want to share, you can share some learnings or challenges which you face through the works of the model village in the field or in the office.
So there is a lot of threats because when the community is coming, they want to surface powerful. So there is a lot of attacks, and also because we have very empowered staff, because in this whole process is the concept of resilience, human dignity, hopes and honor, not only for target group, also for the our staff, also for the our people who is engaged into that. And everybody become very successful human being, and that creates also the jealousness, and that jealousness with the unfortunately converted from friendly contradictions to animatic contradictions in some time. But there is a lot of attacks by the corrupt politicians, corrupt bureaucrats, corrupt police officials. But we have the good support from the good police officials, good bureaucrats, good politicians, the people who born in upper caste but they are against caste system. So in that way we receive that also, and this is the part of thing, because when you are going to change in the power structures, you are going to face